Hi, welcome to LPC Online. I'm Pastor Doug, and I want to thank you for joining us today, especially those who are watching for the first time. If you'd like to connect with us, you can go to our website, listoolpc.com, and leave us a message. We really hope that God uses this time to help you grow in your faith and be encouraged.
Upon your love. Your love surround me. So one day, we were driving down the road, and in the back, I had a few friends. And suddenly, one of my friends said, "Oh my goodness, it burns, it hurts so much." I couldn't figure out what was going on in my car. I turned and looked behind me and realized that he had something that was coming out of his nose. And as I was trying to find out what was going on, still trying to keep my eyes on the road, he suddenly explained to me that it was a Halls. He had thought because a Hall counted as a decongestant that it might work if you put it up your nose as well. Clearly it burned, it was not used the way it was supposed to, and I was trying to explain through my laughter that that is not how you use a Halls. It clearly is supposed to only go in one part of your body. And it caused him a great deal of pain because of it. Through this though, I realized, and he came to realize, there is usually a right way and a wrong way to do something. Many times in life we find ourselves confused with the right way or the wrong way. And we become just as confused as my friend by thinking we can experiment and do things differently. I mean, human nature, we do not like being told what to do, and we don't like being told how to do it, even if the person that's telling us is right. We get so caught up in doing things our way, based on our opinion and our ideas, that we don't care if it's right or wrong because it's what we want to do. Now, this is something we see in many different types of people. Kids are the most easy to experience and see this with because they do the most ridiculous things because they want to do it that way, even though you can clearly see it's the worst idea in the world. But I'm realizing more and more that it's not just individuals and children who operate this way. It's also groups of people. It's also gatherings of people. It could often be churches or businesses or social gatherings that operate this way. People get so caught up in doing something their own way and rebelling against what is expected of them that they often fall into the consequences of their actions because they've done it wrong and it now has an impact on our life. And in this case, I think this is exactly where we're coming into the letter to the Church of Thyatira. Thyatira is an incredible letter because it's a letter that's full of surprises, but touches on this theme, all about the idea of doing what's right and what's wrong. And if you do what's wrong, it comes with consequences. In fact, when we choose to continually do what's wrong and turn against God, and if He's the one leading us into right, every time we rebel against Him, we are choosing then to walk in sin. And that's how things become broken and corrupted. And the question that's brought up is the Church of Thyatira an example of a church that has been corrupted? And I want to bring this up because I think many people nowadays are continually focusing on this idea of the church and asking the same question, is the church corrupted? Have so many people fallen into this rebellion and independence and not doing things according to God's truth that they have become corrupted because they're bringing their own ideas into it, their own perspective, their own will into the situation? And I think this is where, if we have this framework in place, this letter is very powerful and full of surprises. It starts off, of course, with verse 18. In the exact same way, the introduction, and these are the words of Jesus recorded by John. He says, "Write this letter to the angel of the church in Thyatira. This is the letter from the Son of God, whose eyes are like the flames of fire, whose feet are like polished bronze. I know all the things you do. I have seen your love, your faith, your service, and your patient endurance. And I can see your constant improvement in all of these things, but I have this complaint against you. You have permitted that woman, that Jezebel who calls herself a prophet, to lead my servants astray. She teaches them to commit sexual sins and eat food offered the idols. I gave her time to repent, but she does not want to turn away from her immorality. Therefore, I will throw her on a bed of suffering, and those who commit adultery with her will greatly suffer unless they repent and turn away from her evil deeds. I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am the one who searches out the thoughts and intentions of every person. I will give to each one of you whatever you deserve. But I also have a message for the rest of you in Thyatira who have not followed this false teaching, deeper truths as they call them, but the depths of Satan actually. I will ask nothing more of you except that you hold tightly to what you have until I come. To all of you who are victorious, who obey me to the very end, to them I will give authority over all the nations. They will rule the nations with an iron rod and smash them like clay pots. They will have the same authority I received from my Father, and I will also give them the morning star. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what He is saying to the churches." This is our word for today. It's our passage. And it is a passage that, again, on the surface, is very concerning, very challenging. But most people don't understand what it means for us. What is the application for today? And so I want to ask for God's help as we begin to study this and break it down so we can realize how applicable this message is for us. If you join with me. Father, we thank you for your truth. Thank you for your word that you give us. Thank you for sending this great revelation and making John record them so even now we still have the ability to read it and understand, so we can know exactly what was going on with the churches of that time, and more importantly, what we can be able to reference and understand for our own situation and our lives today. We know your word is unfailing, and it is the same yesterday, today, and forever, just like you. So God, may we receive your revelation this morning. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would help us so that we could hear the words, apply them to our lives, be convicted by them, and be able to change our own opinions, our own behavior. We'd be able to truly repent from where we've fallen short and become the people you've called us to. We ask and pray for this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. As I mentioned before, this letter is full of surprises. Thyatira is the smallest of all of the cities and churches that Jesus wrote to and sent these messages to. Yet, it is also the biggest, the longest letter. Unlike Ephesus, Smyrna, and Pergamum, which were major influences within the region for their economic, spiritual, and social power, Thyatira was more like a blue-collar town. Yeah, it was full of farmers and tradespeople and had some guilds, but it really wasn't much of a tourist attraction. It wasn't really a power within that region or a place that people would want to go to. And yet Jesus takes the most time connecting with these people, passing on a message that he felt was important to get them to understand the weight and the significance of what they were going through, and showing them how bad things really were. It begins just like all the other letters. It has that introduction where it says, write these words down and send them to the angel of the church, in this case, Thyatira. But then Jesus starts to bring more of these surprises along. The first one he brings up is he identifies himself as the Son of God. Now, for us, this doesn't seem surprising or shocking. They're like, yeah, that's what Jesus is. But nowhere else in Revelation does he identify himself this way. He doesn't use this term, this name. He doesn't speak this clearly. It's almost like Jesus is going to that Samaritan woman at the well and choosing to strip away all of the religious allusions or writings or words to make it clear and simple. So these simple people of this town, this blue-collar town, would get what he was saying. But then the next thing he brings up is also just as confusing. He brings clarity, but then follows it up by saying, my eyes are on fire. I have fiery eyes, and my feet are of polished bronze. Okay? The first time I heard that, I said, okay, what does that have to do with the Son of God? And what do these two things have even in common? But then when I began to research more and more of it, I began to make a connection of what was going on. Jesus is speaking their language. He's communicating to these believers in a way that they would understand. One of the major trades in Thyatira is actually metalwork or smithing. These people would understand the power of fire, how fire was used to soften metal, to break it down, but also to take away and eliminate all of the impurities in the metal. They would understand that. And when it was tied to someone's eyes, they would recognize it was tied to judgment, that they were able to see with those eyes of fire and have the power to see through all of the barriers and the walls to see what's at the heart of the matter and see all of the impurities and bring judgment on them. That would be a very clear thing they would be able to make the connection of. And then even having feet like polished bronze, that is also a very obvious thing for them. They would recognize, first of all, the wealth that signified and the authority that came with that. Because if a person's feet, which was the dirtiest part of a person's body in that day, were made of polished bronze, it would mean that was wealth, high, high money. Even the feet, which were considered to be the lesser part of the body, was still made of polished bronze, a very expensive metal. And imagine having a person whose feet were made of polished bronze step on your toes. Ouch! Like, that would be such a simple thing to say, wow, that means that he has the ability to crush things under his toes. He has the power within his whole body because his feet are even made of bronze. They would have instantly been able to make those connections and understand what Jesus was talking about. Now, it's great to see how Jesus is, again, making it very clear for these people, but he's also wanting them to recognize what is happening and how he is fully aware with those eyes of fire to see what's going on in their situation and in their hearts. He starts off by bringing this judgment against them. Now, this judgment starts off, thankfully, pretty well. He says, I have seen your love, your faith, your service, your patient endurance. I can see your constant improvement in all of these things. That's pretty high praise. I mean, if that was a church setting now, modern day, that would be a great list of accomplishments. If I was looking for a church and I found one that had love, faith, service, and patient endurance, That would be a church that I would be drawn to because they seem to understand how to live out their faith, to do things that are good and right. Now, there are people, of course, that are obviously keeping busy because they're working in service and love. They're looking beyond themselves and trying to make an impact in their community. That's a great characteristic. And they're also great because their faith and endurance are strong. And Jesus is very clear. You keep improving in these categories. You're doing these things great, but you're getting better at them every single day. They are active in exhibiting their faith. They are active in showing what it means to be a church. But there's something happening, something that is still an issue. And just like Ephesus and Pergamum, the other churches Jesus has already talked about in this region, there's clearly a pattern happening. Because whenever he's bringing a complaint against a church, it seems to be the same complaint. That balance between truth and love and how to properly balance it. Now, if you remember correctly, Ephesus was so good at God's truth. They knew his commandments, they knew his word, and they were doing their best to protect it and to live it out. But they had forgotten love. They had missed out on the whole concept of loving God and loving others. They were doing the right things, but not for the right reasons. And they'd become religious. Now, Pergamum was the opposite. Pergamum had embraced God's love. They were showing what it meant to be loving people in every way, trying to find every opportunity to be loving and accommodating and accepting. But they had missed out on God's truth. And they were starting to fall down that slippery slope because they had missed out on what it meant to follow God's understanding of right and wrong, his commandments he gave us, the righteous behavior he calls his people to. And because of that, God had clearly said to Pergamum, you need to stop because where you're going is wrong. You're falling off this path that I'm calling to you. Well, Thyatira was in the exact same place, except it was further along. They had actually fallen into that trap already. And instead of realizing they were in the midst of it, they had failed to repent and change. They had become stuck in that pattern of behavior, so much so that they had missed out on what it meant to actually be different than the world. They were becoming so accommodating and so just like the community around them that there was no distinction between them and their community. Now, they were the best of their community because they were generous, loving, good people, but they were not actually following God's truth. They weren't following and living by the gospel. And this is why I believe it's important for us to recognize what was going on. In verse 20, Jesus identifies the major issue happening. He says, you are permitting that woman, that prophetess, Jezebel, the one who calls herself a prophet, to lead my servants astray. She's teaching them to commit sexual sin and to eat food offered to idols. Now, this is very important for us because, again, it's similar to the same commandments and concern that Jesus had when he was talking to the church of Pergamum. Now, he identified their Balaam's teaching. In this case, he's identifying the leader of this action in Thyatira as Jezebel. And like Balaam, he's not actually saying people are going back and reading the teachings of Balaam. This is an allusion that's given. It's referencing a person from the past because of what that name meant. Because there would be no way that Jezebel was still alive. This woman is not actually identifying as the real Jezebel, somehow reincarnated or brought back and destroying this church in modern day. No, it's not what he's saying. And it would be foolish of us to believe that there was a parent that would actually name their daughter Jezebel. That would be like a modern set of parents naming their child Hitler. It just wouldn't be done. There is too much negative connotation with that name. You would be messing your child up. You just would not do it. So because of that, we're able to recognize that this is not actually a real life person named Jezebel. It's a leader who is leading people away and into a place of wickedness and evilness. And because of that, Jesus is identifying her actions and her behavior and her heart with the heart of Jezebel, with this person who did the exact same thing with King Ahab to the Israelites years and years and years ago and made them rebel against God and fall away from their faith. And so he's saying, you are pulling these people into idolatry. Now, specifically within that setting, we know that it would have been tied to the guilds in the city because all of the guilds would have had social and spiritual customs that they did to honor the gods and the idols that they were drawn to. Now, specifically in Thyatira, we know that based on the money of the city, that their god that they followed was considered Apollos. And Apollos was identified as the son of God. And so when Jesus says, I am the son of God, he is very clearly speaking against the culture of that city, the culture that the church had begun to accept because they were trying to fit in with these guilds. They were being taught by this leader, this Jezebel, on being okay with all of these pagan and spiritual rituals that were not tied to God because it was fitting in with those people, accepting them. But the problem is she was drawing these people so far away from them that they were embracing all the elements of pagan worship, all the immorality and the actual sexual sins that came with it, because that's how the other people worshiped. So much so these Christians were actually living almost like two separate lives because they were trying to be Christian on the one hand, but have everything else that came with it, everything else that the world was offering. So they weren't exclusive with their faith. It wasn't about following God and only God, which last time I checked is the first commandment. It's literally God saying you shall have no other God before me. Oh, and the second one, have no idols to worship. This woman was coming along and saying, no, that was for then. This is now and it's different. And it's totally fine for us to do that because it's all about the love and acceptance of God. It's all about grace on grace on grace. It's not about any truth. And they had made that choice and were being led astray by her. So much so that they were getting to a place where they were falling away from their faith. This church was going from being a compromised church to being a full-out corrupted church. And the worst part about it too is Jesus was still being gracious to her and patient and saying, I gave her time to repent, but she does not want to turn away from her immorality. And now she is turning other people away in droves and continuing to draw them further and further away. Therefore, it is now time for me to step up as the judge. Yes, I have been gracious and loving and kind to her, but now the truth element is coming into play. And now I will be judging her and punishing her for her sin and her actions. Verse 22 says, therefore, I will throw her in a bed of suffering. It's funny. She's committing sexual sins and teaching these other people to commit sexual sins with her. And he's saying that bed that she normally has sin inside of is going to become her bed of punishment. It's actually, the word is identified as a brier, which is a bed that a dead body would be put on that would be sent away to be burned. And here he's saying, literally, this bed is now becoming a bed of punishment and suffering for her. And for those who commit adultery with her, they will greatly suffer unless they repent and turn away from her wicked deeds. I love how this shows Jesus, even in his judgment, even in him bringing his correction that needs to happen because this church is being corrupted and led astray, he is still being gracious and saying, if they repent and turn away from their evil deeds, there's still a chance for them. I'm still giving them grace if they're willing to accept it. But I will strike all of her children dead. Now, I don't believe this is actually meaning her literal children, but there is no distinction given here. But in that time, in that language, often the people who would follow a teacher would be called their children. I believe what Jesus is saying here is, I'm actually going to punish her children, her followers, the people who are falling into those same sins and continue to become tied to her teaching, not her actual children who have nothing to do with their mom's actions unless they themselves are evil too. Now that's again based on personal opinion, but I believe that's the language that is being communicated here. I will strike all of her followers dead. Then all of the churches will know that I am the one, and this is where I love again, that idea of fiery eyes. I am the one who searches out the thoughts and the intentions of every person. He is truly that judge that sees through every barrier we put up, everything we try to hide, to see what's really going on in our hearts and our minds, our real thoughts and our feelings. And he will do this with every person, then give each of them whatever they deserve. That means that he is a good judge. Yes, he is a divine judge who can see through all of that stuff, but he also is able to recognize what's truly going on in the hearts of these people, and they will be judged accordingly. if they are rebelling and they are caught up in all of this adultery and sin, if they have truly left their faith to fall into this sin and not be called God's holy people, then they will receive the judgment they deserve. But here's where there is again another ray of hope brought forward. Yes, Thyatira is a church that is corrupted. Yes, I truly believe that it had become corrupted, but he brings up the fact that it's also a church divided. In verse 24, I also have a message for the rest of you in Thyatira who have not followed this false teaching. There is still a core group of people in that church who are being faithful to God, who are standing by their understanding of his truth and his word, and they are honoring his truth. They are living by his commands and not falling into the same traps that this person is promoting and saying, yes, God is right. This is good. But we can also have this too. We can have God's word and we can have all these other things in our life. We don't need to be exclusive. And these people are saying, no. We need to remain faithful to God's teaching. What he tells us not to do, we should not do. What he commands us to avoid, we should avoid. What he says is wrong is wrong, even though our culture and our world is saying differently. And yes, God calls us to be loving, but it doesn't mean we have to be accommodating and accepting. We can still be set in our own realization of God's moral compass, his truth, and that should be our guide to our life. Those should be the principles we live by, the values we order our life by. And he says here, these are the people who have not followed these false teachings, the deeper truths, as they call them. The depths of Satan, actually. He's very strong in this. Now, the deeper truths that are being brought up are tied specifically to the teachings that were brought up, the idea of Gnosticism, the idea of being higher and more understanding. They've transcended that level of understanding to bigger things. And he's saying, no, you think you have a better truth or a better understanding or a new revelation from God, but what you have done is you've fallen for the trap of Satan. That's not higher truths, that's the depths of Satan. And then he says, of these people who have remained faithful, I will ask nothing more of you. It's not your job to fix all of these other people. I'm not placing that burden on top of you. This is where many of us fall right now because we see a church that currently is around us. We see people who are Christians who are falling into that trap of sin. And then we become the judge. We become the person who's highly critical. And we try to walk alongside of them and be like, you need to change. And Jesus is saying, no, you're not the one who's supposed to do all of that. Yes, you're called to hold each other accountable, but it's through the Holy Spirit. And in this case, he's saying, I'm asking nothing more of you. You can't fix all of this. Except the one thing I ask of you is to hold tightly to what you have until I come. Hold tightly to what you have. Your revelation and understanding of me. Your faith. Your understanding of what I have. Hold tightly to these things. Don't fall. Don't become one of those people who are led astray. Don't fall for that trap. Hold tightly to what you know to be true until I come, because I am going to be coming back. And then he brings this ending with his promise. And this is where I love his promise. It ties again with this same imagery, same language to the people, but in a powerful message. He says, to all who are victorious, to those people who are holding tightly and are faithful to the things of me, to all of those who repent and come back to me, you would be the ones who are victorious. To you and who obey me to the very end. Then he quotes Psalm 2. I will give them all authority over all the nations. They will rule the nations with an iron rod and smash them like clay pots. This is a strong imagery, an early idea of the Messiah. In Psalm 2, when it's given, it's talking about the authority and the power of God and the one who is coming as the Son of God. This is showing the authority that Jesus has. And then he says in verse 28, they will have the same authority that I received from the Father. This was God's authority. He's saying, I'm going to give you that same authority. And I will also give them the morning star. The morning star. Now, there are many different ways to show this illusion or this imagery. There are many people that have ideas on exactly what it means. But the most common one that people have is the morning star, is the rising of the sun. It's the light coming after a time of darkness, showing you that there is hope coming for you too. As much as our world is crazy and there are all these things that are going wrong, I have hope coming. And it will be dawning soon, and then you will be able to have that light again. The light will be brought to you. As much as you feel like you're in a time in a world of darkness, the morning star will come again. And with the authority that I'm giving to you, you will have the ability to have the exact same authority that I have, that I receive from the Father. You will receive the same. Then he says in verse 29, anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. This is a powerful, powerful teaching for us today, I believe. Because as much as this was a letter for the church of Thyatira, and it was for that time and that stage, we live in a very similar reality. We live in a time where our church, in many ways, has fallen into corruption. Every day, it seems like there are more and more reports coming out of pastors, of spiritual leaders, of evangelists, of teachers, of all of these people who are tied to our kingdom work that's being done on the earth, our church family, who are falling, who are discovering that they've been living a lie and are hypocritical and have truly had some other form of effort and work they've been doing on the side and presented it as God's work. It's not hard to look at the church right now and say, yeah, it's corrupted. Yeah, there are things that are going on in the church where you can see it has fallen under the influence of things that are evil, not of God, not of good. But I believe that we need to be like Jesus and not just sell the church off, not to write it off and be like, yeah, it's done. It's had its time. It is too corrupted. It cannot be saved. But to believe that the same Jesus that could save the church of Thyatira is the same Jesus today who can save our church, the churches that we're a part of, the global church that has fallen into some of those same traps. He can save them too. And I don't believe it's supposed to be our mission to take it on and try to fix everything. We can't possibly do that. The only person we can fix is ourselves. Those are the only things that we can fix. But I think that it's also important for us to recognize too and ask ourselves this question. If Jesus were to come, and if he were to show up and bring that same judgment against us and against our local churches, how would he identify us? What would he say? Would we be the people that he would found as guilty? The ones who have corrupted and fallen away. The ones who have given in to every single temptation of this world. And our faith that once started strong has become so tainted and corrupted by the outside influences that we've let in that we now need to be punished as well. Would he be the people that he says, you know what, yes, you've fallen, but you can still repent and turn back to me if you are willing. Will you repent and turn back to God? Are we the ones who are open to that and willing to make that change? Or are we the ones that he'll come down and say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have held tightly to my truth. You have proven faithful, even when your brothers and sisters around you have decided to live differently. Even when the outside influences of our culture have become so permeated within the church that there's now no distinction of what is gospel and what is of the world. You have held tightly to what is true, what is right. And for that, I will be able to reward you. But first, you must hold tightly until I come again. How is Jesus going to say we are right now? How are we living? And how is our church living? These are the things that he's calling us to do. We're held accountable for those things. But we can't change the global church. Unless all of us are willing to change our own lives around, then we would have a faithful church. Then we would have a faithful community gathering. Then we would be able to impact greater things, churches around us, our whole region. If we're willing to be faithful, we can repent and turn from our mistakes and sins. And we can prove that we are the ones who are holding tightly to God's truth while not falling for the same trap as the Ephesians and forgetting his love. We're called to balance these two things. Because the God that we serve and calls us to imitate knows how to operate in grace and truth. Truth and love. All the time. And that's what he's calling us to today. Let's say a word. Father, we thank you for the fact that you can give us this warning. Yes, it happened for people thousands of years ago. But it still is something that's very applicable today. And it's a great question and assessment that we should ask ourselves. Are we truly living for you? Are we truly holding to your truth? Have we continued to hold to the things that we know are right and not fallen into the things that are wrong? Have we not allowed them to come into our life because we're just trying to embrace and accept all things, be loving and merciful to all things? Can we still hold to your truth and choose to live by it today? Make them our values that we guide our life by. We ask and we pray, God, for the times that we've messed up. May we repent. May we not be like that person called Jezebel because they're choosing to not turn back to you. They're failing to be willing to repent. May we choose to accept our issues and the ways we have fallen short. Identify that sin and repent of it so that we can be one of those people who are faithfully following you today and then holding tightly to what we know is yours and what is your truth. We ask and we pray for help with this today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you for engaging with this truth. It's a strong letter, but it's also a letter that's very applicable to us. And I hope it's being able to bring that same challenge and hope to you today. I want to read a benediction out taken from Jude, verses 24 and 25. And it's an incredible passage, but it's also something that I want to declare over us. And it says, "Now all glory to God, who is able to keep us from falling away and bring us with great joy into his glorious presence in that final day without a single fault. May all glory, majesty, power, and authority be to him and before him, before all time, in the present and beyond all time." Amen? Amen. May that be the same God that we have today. May he continue to keep us from falling away, from compromising, and from having the chance to be standing before him one day and hearing him say those things to us. "You are without fault. You are faithful. Well done, my servant." Amen? Amen. Thank you so much. I pray you have a blessed week and an amazing day, and you go walk with God. Take care.